Welcome to this lecture series on environment and ecology presented by Mentors for IAS in association with Bangalore IAS Academy and Nama KPSC. So in this particular video, we'll be briefly discussing about soil pollution as well as solid waste, pollution which is caused by solid waste and a few measures when it comes to solid waste management. Now, soil pollution refers to the contamination of soil with high concentrations of toxic substances and a serious environmental concern since it poses many health hazards. For example, exposure to soil containing high concentrations of benzene increases the risk of leukemia. High exposure to high concentrations of benzene in soil increases the risk of leukemia. So soil naturally contains compounds that are harmful or toxic to human beings as well as other organisms. But when does it actually become harmful? Naturally it does contain compounds, but it does not result in harm. It is only when these compounds increase to such a level or increase beyond a certain concentration will it actually cause damage to the ecosystem as well as the organs in it. It does not mean that just because there are some contaminants present in the soil, it will actually result in harm to the ecosystem or the organisms actually living in it. It is only when they increase beyond a certain concentration. Next, we will look into the different causes of soil pollution. Now, obviously, over here, I have mentioned different or various causes of soil pollution. However, for the sake of explanation, I will be classifying the causes of soil pollution into two types. One is naturally caused soil pollution. The other is anthropogenic soil pollution. So I am classifying the causes of soil pollution into two types. Naturally caused soil pollution and anthropogenic soil pollution, nothing but man-made. First, discussing about naturally caused soil pollution. See, natural processes can also lead to accumulation of toxic chemicals in the soil, meaning soil pollution can also happen naturally. For example, you can consider the accumulation of high levels of perchlorate ions. High levels of perchlorate ions in soil from the Atacama Desert in Chile. Now, this is nothing but a type of accumulation which is due to a natural process in arid environments. So, this is also a type of soil pollution and happens naturally when it comes to arid regions. Similarly, soil pollution can also happen or take place due to human activities. We are referring to it as anthropogenic soil pollution. So this anthropogenic or man-made contaminants are actually the main cause of soil pollution and consist of a large variety of contaminants, both organic and inorganic, which is usually due to improper disposal of waste, generally from agricultural activities, excessive industrial activities, and inefficient disposal of waste. So even though soil pollution can take place naturally, most of it is nothing but due to human activities, especially agricultural activities, industrial activities, and inefficient disposal of waste, which actually results in soil pollution. Next, what are the main or the chief pollutants which actually cause pollution or soil pollution? Some of the most hazardous soil pollutants are xenobiotics. Some of the most hazardous soil pollutants are known as xenobiotics. Xenobiotics are chemical substances that are not naturally found in nature but are synthesized by humans. They are not naturally found in nature but synthesized by humans. And most of these xenobiotics are known to be carcinogenic. They are known to be carcinogenic and they cause soil pollution. So here we will briefly discuss about few of the pollutants. The first is heavy metals. So the presence of heavy metals, not just in water, even the presence of heavy metals in soil can also lead to damage to the ecosystem. So whenever you have the presence of heavy metals such as mercury, lead, arsenic, cadmium, chromium, etc., all this can result in soil becoming highly toxic to human beings. These metals enter soil through mining activities, agriculture, e-waste and medical waste, and can also end up polluting water sources as well. So heavy metals actually cause a lot of damage, not just to human beings but also the other organisms which depend upon the ecosystem. Second is pH, polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons. Polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons contain only carbon and hydrogen atoms. They only have carbon and hydrogen atoms and also contain more than one aromatic rings. They contain more than one aromatic rings. So you can take naphthalene or anthracene. These are all nothing but your polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons. The reason they are harmful is that exposure to polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons may cause cancer. And these polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons enter soil from the processing of coke or vehicular emissions or even certain other industrial activities from which it can enter soil if not properly discharged. Another big reason for soil pollution is nothing but industrial waste. The discharge of industrial waste directly into soil can also result in soil pollution. So you can have dioxins or your PCBs, that is polychlorinated biphenyls, industrial solvents, when directly discharged into soil without any kind of containment can result in soil pollution as well. Apart from that, one of the biggest factors or causes causing pollution is nothing but agriculture, where in agriculture we indiscriminately are using pesticides, herbicides or fungicides and also insecticides, and when used in excess they are entering into the soil, which will also reduce soil productivity and also lead to soil pollution, and this will enter the food system, and once it enters the food system can result in biomagnification across the food web or the food chain and eventually start to harm human beings as well. Therefore, it is very important to prevent soil pollution, because if soil pollution is not prevented, it can enter into the food chain, and once it enters into the food chain, it does not affect only those organisms which are consuming it in the initial stages, but due to biomagnification tremendously affects other organisms in the higher levels of the food chain. Okay, next we'll just briefly discuss about the effects of soil pollution. So you can see over here as to how soil pollution actually affects. There are different reasons as to why we have to prevent soil pollution. Apart from the reasons which are already mentioned over here, you can also consider few other reasons. For example, soil pollution can also contribute towards acid rain by releasing ammonia into the atmosphere. It can also cause acid rain, not cause, contribute towards acid rain. When you have volatile contaminants, for example, since volatile contaminants in the soil can be carried away into the atmosphere by winds or can seep into underground water reserves, soil pollution can directly contribute to air pollution and water pollution as well. Here, as it is already mentioned, it can also affect agriculture as it reduces soil fertility and crop yield. It might also affect the vegetation in a particular area and thereby bring down the balance or affect the balance of flora and fauna in a particular region. So these are the different effects of soil pollution on the ecosystem. Please do try to remember them, because in your UPSC sometimes you may have questions where there are statements which give out the effects of soil pollution. Say for example, if it says that soil pollution directly causes air pollution or water pollution, then you should know that is this particular statement true or false. That is why it is important to know such statements and such information when you take up your examination. Before taking up solid waste, I would just like to mention that, see, when it comes to soil pollution, controlling this type of pollution is easy, provided we take the necessary steps and these steps are implemented. We only have to bring about better management into agricultural practices. And if this can be done, if farmers can be educated to inculcate better management, better use of pesticides, insecticides and herbicides, soil pollution up to a great extent can be reduced. Another big problem is nothing but solid waste management. If waste disposal can also be managed, soil pollution can be reduced to a great extent. And we do have some other remedial measures like bioremediation or phytoremediation. If time does permit, we can take it up later. Bioremediation, phytoremediation, or even mycoremediation. Okay. So next, we'll take up solid waste. Now, this is very simple. Solid waste refers to man-made waste or garbage, mostly plastic, which are discarded in the environment and often found in the sea, floating on land or even submerged, and ends up in accumulation zones such as the mouths of rivers, estuaries or the sea. Apart from that, solid waste may also include sludge from wastewater treatment, industrial, commercial, mining, agricultural or municipal waste as well. All these things can be considered to be solid waste. So here what we will do is, we will classify solid waste broadly into three types. One is municipal waste, the second is hazardous waste, and the third is hospital waste. Municipal waste is simple. This generally includes household waste, plastic, construction debris, as well as sanitation residue. All these things are considered to be municipal waste. Hazardous waste refers to toxic substances which may be corrosive, inflammable or even explosive. They are generally toxic in nature. Hazardous wastes are mostly generated from industrial sector, but some may even be household wastes such as old medicines, paints, solvents, batteries or acids, disinfectants, which are also used in our homes. Finally, we have hospital waste. Hospital waste is generated during the diagnosis, treatment or immunization of humans or animals, as well as in biomedical research. But since the notification of the Biomedical Waste Handling and Management Rules 1998. Biomedical Waste Handling and Management Rules 1998. Hospital waste segregation, collection, treatment and disposal has been streamlined as of today. So as of today, hospital waste, the way hospital waste is discharged has been streamlined to a great extent thanks to the notification of this Biomedical Waste Handling and Management Rules 1998. Next, we'll briefly take up the disposal of solid waste. How can we dispose of solid waste? The first method is open dumps, the most common type of disposal. Open dumps refer to uncovered areas where all the waste are dumped together. So all kinds of solid waste which is untreated and uncovered and not segregated is all dumped in an open area. This, however, results in becoming a breeding ground for rats, flies and also the spread of diseases, especially when it rains, because this rainwater will carry away several effluents from there, several of these chemicals which might be over there. All these things will be carried away by rainwater into other water bodies or seeps into soil, thereby causing further and more pollution. Second is landfills. Now landfills is simple compared to open dumps. It's more expensive but simple. So here what we will do is, here a pit is dug out and all the garbage is dumped into this pit, following which this pit is covered by layers of soil and it is sealed, which prevents the breeding of rats and flies when compared to open dumps. However, the main problem when it comes to landfill is contamination of soil and groundwater, which may take place. This is known as landfill. Open dump is where everything is dumped on some open area indiscriminately. Landfill is where a pit is dug out, a pit is formed, and all the waste is dumped in that pit and then sealed with a layer of soil. Next, if you take up sanitary landfills are very similar to landfills. However, sanitary landfills solve the problem of soil and groundwater contamination, which was seen in landfills. This is because when it comes to sanitary landfills, the pit is lined with impermeable materials such as plastic and clay, and it is also built over impermeable soil. So since the surroundings are impermeable, the sides as well as the base of the pit is impermeable, any contaminant, any pollutant is not able to seep through it and cause soil pollution or groundwater pollution. Therefore, sanitary landfills are much more efficient in terms of solid waste disposal or disposal when compared to landfill, but sanitary landfills are more expensive in nature. Second, we have incineration plants. Very simple, incineration plants is where all the garbage is simply burnt. Generally, non-recyclable materials are burnt in large furnaces where the heat generated may be used as a source of energy for power production, But the main problem is that burning of such garbage may result in the production of toxic gases, the release of toxic gases into the atmosphere. Similar to incineration plants, we have pyrolysis. Now, pyrolysis can be considered to be more efficient. This is where all the waste is combusted. Pyrolysis is the combustion of waste in the absence of oxygen or in a controlled environment where oxygen is limited in nature. When waste is combusted in the absence of oxygen, the gases and liquids which are produced may be collected later to be used as fuel. This is known as pyrolysis. Then we have composting. Now, composting is actually a biological process where microorganisms will decompose degradable waste, and humus that is generated in this process can be used as an addition to soil. So whenever you compost biodegradable waste, you get humus. Humus can be added to soil, which increases the properties of soil because humus increases the ability of soil to hold water. Therefore, this process is actually beneficial. A better method of composting is vermiculture, where along with this, earthworms are also added. So vermiculture is known as earthworm farming. So what happens is, earthworms are added to the compost, where earthworms will also break down organic waste and their excreta makes the compost rich in nutrients. Therefore, this can be used as a fertilizer, which increases the fertility of soil. So with this, we complete our brief discussion about soil pollution and also solid waste management, as to different methods as to how solid waste can be managed. If you do have any doubts, please do write to us. If possible, if time permits later, we can actually take up more and more legislations which actually deal with different types of pollutions. So thank you for watching. Please do follow for more such videos.